Pick a Side Nation. How's everyone doing today? I'm your host, James Finley, with the Pick a Side Podcast. We are on day three of our first annual Black Breast Cancer Awareness Action Week. We have a very special guest coming into the lab, survivor Cherise Champion Williams. And a little side note to Cherise, as I was speaking with Cherise, she's the one that brought to my awareness that she said, hey, we should replace that awareness and put action on there. So here's a little tribute to Cherise for me using the word action into our theme for the whole entire week. So thank you so very much for that. But please join us today. She has some very good information that she was able to share with me about her journey through breast cancer. So I hope that you sit back and relax. Cherise Champion Williams, survivor. I'll catch you on the other side. Pick a Side Nation, how's everyone doing? I'm your host, James Finley, with the Pick a Side Podcast. And this is day number three for breast cancer awareness. And we have another survivor that is coming into the lab to talk about her journey. And I'm so very thankful that she had an opportunity to come in to discuss her journey. And we are going to introduce into the lab Cherise Williams. How are you doing today?
I am well, James. Thank you. I am honored that you asked me to come on and just discuss a little bit about my story and my journey.
So for the Pick a Side audience, I just want everyone to know, because I always like to have a little fun. It took us a minute for us to get going on this little podcast because somebody wasn't coming out good. So the old cell phone is what we using today. And as you all see, Cherise is looking really, really good with the cell phone. So we want to thank God for this advanced technology that we have. So Cherise, so tell the audience a little bit about yourself.
Well, I am just had a birthday. I turned 54 years old. I've been married 28 years.
Amen.
28 long years. I have three wonderful children. I attend Faithful Central Bible Church here in Englewood. I've lived in Englewood 25 of those years. And I'm the vice president of sales at dirt.com, which is a real estate site owned by Penske Media Corp.
I have so many friends that attend Faithful Central Bible Church. So I've been over there many times. So we are so very happy to have you on the podcast. And I'm trying to say, this is not something sad to talk about, but it's something that I think a lot of, especially women of color, should know about what's going on with breast cancer. And as you being a breast cancer survivor, and I hope everyone can read the shirt that she has on. It says, I am healed, Isaiah 53:5. And for some of you non-Bible scholars, that's in the Old Testament, just want to put it on out there. So tell me what life was like before January of 2017. I mean, just everything was peaches and herb. How was it before that date?
Like you said, everything was everything. I had just come back to working at the, I guess I can say it, LA Times. I was there for 22 years. Mm-hmm. I left for 9 years to raise my last baby at home. Went back to the LA Times, and I was in a sales position, account executive, handling $3 million a year revenue, just doing my job, going to see my clients. I also volunteer in a ministry at Faithful Central called Rites of Passage, where we mentor young boys 12 to 15. I did that every Saturday from 6 to 11. Life was just normal, you know.
All right, so we had Christmas of December of 2016. Then we go into the new year of 2017. So what led to you going to the doctor as to find out, you know, find out what you, that you have breast cancer?
So I actually had been taking my mammograms consistently. Mm-hmm. And I recall one of those times 2 years prior, the doctor saying, "Huh, we see something, but we don't know what that is. We're not quite sure. It looks like a cyst. We want to see you in 6 months." So, you know, I'd go, maybe I'll go back in 8 months, or I'll do a year or whatever. But I would go back. And each time it was, "Well, we see something, but it didn't look like it really grew. I'm almost 90% sure that it was a cyst. We're almost sure it's a cyst." And I'm like, okay. So I didn't have any alarm or anything until, this is how God works. I left the company, came back. And my boss at the time when I came back was my boss the last time I was there. And she had also left mm-hmm. and came back. And I was telling her the story about how they had been telling me come back every 6 months. And she said, "Have them biopsy it." And I'm like, "Huh, I never thought to do something like that." Because you know what? A lot of times when a doctor tells us something, we want to believe the doctors and we want to be okay. And since they said, "Oh, it's just the cyst, you're okay," I took that. But then it took for that lady, our encounter, for her to say, "Have them biopsy." So when the doctor called me, I did ask them and they said, "Yeah, we should probably do that." And yeah, that's how the story went. I was sitting at work one day. I got a call from the doctor after he biopsied it a few days later, and we missed calls. And it was like I would call him, he would miss me. He would call, but we kept back and forth. And I just knew the fact that they kept saying, "He wants to speak to you," I knew then I had it. So I closed my computer, got in my car and said, "See you guys, I'm going home."
You know, something that you and I had talked about the other day, everybody knows their own body. Everybody, I don't care what anyone says, you know your own body because you live with that body. You know how that body feels every single day, and you know what it responds to. You know when everything's been okay, and then all of a sudden, one day you got a little pain, then that pain, it just goes on to the next day and it's not going away. You can take aspirin and you know something is not right. And so for you to kind of know that, okay, something's not right, that's something inside of you is saying, "Hey, we need to check this out." So Cherise, you know, as I was speaking with a couple of other ladies regarding this topic. So, you know that the doctor, you already said, you know, the doctor probably didn't have good news. Were you timid about talking to him because you knew that it may have been some bad news, or did you just want to hurry up and find out what it was?
That's a good question. I felt like I was kind of left hanging, and I probably should not have driven home because it was on my mind, you know, as I'm driving. So I totally don't even know how I got home. Right. But I did pull over when we did finally get a chance to connect. I pulled over to have that conversation with him. And I wanted to know what's going on. What is it? Why do you have to talk to me? But I kind of knew what direction the conversation was going to go. And not only did he say, "I'm sorry, yes, it is cancer," but we found another area that's suspicious that I also want a biopsy that was right next to it. So I had to go back in for another biopsy, and it too was cancer, yeah.
So not only are you finding out something that you've already had a biopsy on, now they found something in addition. So mentally, what's going on in your head? You've already... You know, because the first time where someone hears the word cancer, they automatically like, okay, this is the end. This is, you know, it's like a death sentence. So where was your mental state of mind at during this particular time?
Well, first you go numb. You don't hear anything after the word cancer, right? Yep.
Yep.
And so that's first thing is I went numb. And for me, I have a really good village, my husband, my mom, my sisters and things like that. So I immediately had to call my support system. Like I needed them to carry me because after that I was numb. You know, I couldn't feel, hear, think, nothing. So I had to call that support system. And and so though there was nights I laid on the couch and I was like, I'm dying. I'm going to die. Yeah. That does cross your mind.
So that let's talk about the support system. I feel like whether it's cancer, any type of illness, you know, when we take those vows, you say, hey, for better, for worse, sickness and health, death do us apart, death do us part. I feel like that support is so important because when you're alone, that old man, the devil, start creeping up into your head and starts making you believe whatever the worst is. And we all need people that can lift us up, that can inspire us and let us know, hey, it's going to be okay. So did you have that type of support to where you had people that was encouraging you and letting you know, hey, we gonna get through this together, things of this nature?
Let me tell you, I'm a Christian woman. I don't know, you know, what a lot of your audience believes. I'm sure everybody believes in some higher power or source or the universe or mother, you know. But I have to fill my life around with people who are like-minded. And you, like I said, I go to Faithful Center Bible Church, so you know where I'm coming from. Mm-hmm. So I have to be around people who are like-minded, who believe right. in the Bible. Am I still there?
You still here? Go ahead.
Okay, yeah. And so I have to surround myself with like-minded people who believe in the Bible and the Word, where it says, by his stripes you are healed. I have to be around people who are Bible-believing, water-baptized, Holy Ghost-filled people. Because there were some people that I told my story to who immediately put me in the ground. Oh, my God, I'm so sorry. Oh, God. I mean, they were crying. I'm like, why are you crying? I got the cancer, not you. Why are you crying?
Yeah,
they
yeah.
were ready to put me in the ground. Yeah.
You know, encouragement, like I said, is so important. And you said, you just said something, Cherise. You said you have to put yourself around people who are like-minded. People who don't have a relationship with God, it's hard for them to understand where you're getting this faith from. You know, why are you walking around here, you know, with your head lifted high, you know, like you've been not diagnosed with one type of cancer, but another type of cancer. So I just feel I'm with you 100% on that. You know, my podcast, I tell people all the time, hey, I'm going to put God first in everything I do because I know where my blessings come from. And, you know, my Pick a Sky audience, they kind of know my story. About when I was bedridden, and I know who I had to go to. I had to get everybody out of my room and say, hey, I have to talk to God, because sometimes you don't have a support group. And sometimes you have to have a conversation with the Lord. So when you got all this information, you had to share it with your husband, you had to share it with your sister. And then at some point, you know, your kids, you know, had to, you brought your kids into that as well. So what was it like when you had to start going through the different procedures, for trying to, get this cancer out of you?
So that was, funny that you said that. First of all, I didn't tell my children because I didn't want to worry them. They kind of found out through osmosis. I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing, but one thing I did know is that I had to model for them what it looks like when you are given bad news or something traumatic happens in your life.
Wow.
My kids they're college age, and then I have what I call a bonus baby who came along 10 years later. So I'm still raising a baby here, but still I had to model for them. How does it look? How do you press through when tough, difficult situations come along? Mm. And so I stayed up the entire time I could. And for that 14-year-old now that was 10 years old, when I went through my chemo treatments, I knew by day 3 or 4, I was going to go down. And so what I would do is I would get dressed and put on makeup and lipstick and this and like, let's go to the movies. Let's go get our nails done. I try to make life as normal for her as possible. Normal. And for myself, it made me feel good to dress up. It made me feel good. So I wasn't just laying around and succumbing and giving into the treatments, because the treatments are bad. They're pretty bad treatment. You go in and they're hooking these bags up with cross skulls and crossbones, and they're red and you know, so I mean, you're looking at them change these bags one after another of chemo. I had to do 5 cocktails of this chemo, which of course made my hair and everything come out. I had to do that for 6 months, every 21 days. And they had to monitor my heart because one of them was really strong. And then I had to do 6 months of just one of the medicines for the remaining 6 months, because I was diagnosed HER2 positive. Now, if you want to get a cancer, which you don't, apparently HER2 positive that I had works really well with the treatment. So, and what I did when you say that village, I said, hey, you guys, I'm going to chemo today. And I had people, speaking in the village, taking off of work and getting mad because they wanted to take me to chemo. No, I'm taking her next week. No, I'm a taker. No, I'm a taker. I was blessed. I was so blessed. Mm. But, you know, when we text the family, cousins and all that and say, Cherise is going to chemo today, our prayer was for no side effects. And literally, other than my hair falling out, I really had no side effects from the chemo.
Look at that.
So what my message would be to everybody is, don't be scared of the 2 C words, cancer and chemo, because it's not our grandmamas and great grandmamas, cancer and chemo. Okay, I might be skipping a gun. You might be getting ready to ask me a question, but if you catch this thing quick enough, most of the cancers, they're curable.
Cherise, you're the second person today that has said the same thing, that your mother's cancer is different than what it is now, because, you know, we've been blessed where, you know, medicine is so much different. And, you know, we can't always, and for that Christian individual out there that says, well, we're just going to pray and see what God does. The Bible tells us that, you know, there's a whole lot of things that go along with prayer. And we have to have also wisdom that goes along with that as well, where we can go to the doctors and have the faith that they are going to have the knowledge to be able to treat whatever it is. So I want your mess. I want you to tell the young lady or whoever the person of age may be, color, whatever background, what is the single most thing that you've learned from this whole ordeal?
I think the biggest thing is that you have to be an advocate for your health. Mm. If you feel something, say something. Mm. When you go to the doctors, press the doctors. Get gangster with it. You know, mm. I had to go in there and bring my gang, my mama, husband, sisters with me. And when the doctors walk in the office, they look around, ooh, y'all need some more chairs in here? It's kind of tight. And then I look over to the doctor. I say, oh, and by the way, my sister's taping this conversation because I don't hear anything. Because once they said cancer, hear anything from this point on. They're my ears and eyes and everything. So I tell them, my sister's taping this on her iPhone, by the way. And the doctor was cool with it. And you get the right doctor. I had to drop a doctor. I was like, okay, you don't have the right bedside manner. I just been told that I have a disease that could potentially kill me. And for you, I'm another number. And I get it. They can't write emotionally attached. I kind of get that. But that's what I need from you. I need to know that or think that you care about me. And so you have to make sure you get, I researched doctors. I was Googling them and I had my sister in them Googling and Googling questions to ask the doctors. I just say you have to be an advocate over your health, get gangster with it, go in there and do not let them doctors shush you out the office. That's the biggest thing I've learned.
You just said a mouthful. When I was looking for doctors, I went through a research. And I said, hey, I'm not going to let you all give me a doctor. I'm going to do my due diligence on this. And, you know, and I asked God, I prayed. I said, God, I said, lead me to the person that you feel is going to have my best interest at heart. Lead me to the doctor that is going to be able to tell me I don't need to be buffered or nothing like that. I want a doctor that's going to be very straightforward with me and tell me. And I don't need to have no gloves on or be pat on the back, but I wanted someone that was going to be firm, but still someone that I felt comfortable. And I felt very comfortable to find out that my doctor, she loves the Lord just like I do. And so, you know, we have that bond with each other. And, you know, so that I think that's really, really important. So going forward, because you and I, there's so many things that you can talk about, because I can talk about the Lord all day long. So I want to keep this. I want to keep this about breast cancer. What's the biggest message that you have in regard to that person that's skeptical about going to get checked?
You know, I think about that often. You know, I say to maybe somebody like my daughter, you know, fortunately, I was able to get genetics testing and found out that I don't carry the BRCA gene, and it's not really in our family, breast cancer. So she's okay. So I wouldn't recommend her going any earlier. But if you have a history of breast cancer in your family, then you do want to start pushing your way in and saying, I need to get mammograms earlier than what the government or whoever says you're supposed to get them. That's number one. Right. But, you know, I would tell my daughter, for that 2 seconds of discomfort that you're going to go through is worth it than to potentially die or have to go through chemo, you know, and again, my message was, it's not the same if you catch it early enough. I caught it early. You know, I'm going on year 5 next year. I will be in that category where it will not return. And just, you didn't ask me, but the treatment that I went through, not only did I do chemo, but I also had a bilateral mastectomy. So I had both breasts removed. Mm-hmm. I just didn't want to deal with it no more. I didn't want it to come back. I had both breasts removed and then did reconstruction. And so I would, like I said, tell my daughter, if you can catch it early enough and go through whatever procedures you have to, it's not the same cancer. Like I said, I had no side effects other than losing my hair. I did find out that I had lupus and diabetes during the treatment. And, you know, I was like, come on, devil, what else you going to throw at me? You know, I'm already in the fight, so you can't throw nothing else at me. I'm good.
Well, you know, Cherise, sometimes I know we say, why me, Lord? Why do I have to go through this? And as I was saying, telling somebody else, sometimes we got to say, why not me? Sometimes God have to take us through our own individual test, and we got to go through our own thing. But the thing now is that since God has brought you out of this, now you have your own personal testimony. And just as you're doing today, where you're speaking about it and being very transparent about it, we need more people to speak about what they've been through, because we have so many people that are in silence and they're afraid. They don't have a support group. They don't have health insurance. And they don't know which way to turn. I'm hoping that your message that you've had today is going to be able to help someone to make that decision to go get checked. Because, you know, early detection is everything. And I feel like, you know, these messages that I've been hearing this week in regards to Breast Cancer Awareness Week has been very, very powerful. So going forward, is there anything that you're doing, you know, being an advocate for breast cancer that you're doing right now?
Not right now. And you know what? We're going to change this. We're going to call it Breast Cancer Activation Month. We already aware about breast cancer, right? Everybody, October, everybody going to wear pink. Everybody going to do this and that. We're going to call it. It's not awareness anymore. It's activation.
Activate.
Like, we're gonna make sure we don't get cancer in the first place. We're gonna have a good diet. We're gonna eat our what are they called? Cruciferous vegetables, which is your, you know, your Brussels sprouts and your broccoli and your cauliflower, which helps to scrape your body of all the toxins so we don't get dis-ease. We're going to not stress out, and we're going to work out. So we're going to activate right now this month. That's what we're going to do. And then we're going to go get our screenings, our mammograms. We're going to check ourselves monthly and make sure we're doing all the right things. We're not going to call it awareness month anymore. So that's number one. And what was your question? I'm sorry, I went on a tangent.
Well, listen, listen. We don't even have to say any more of that because you just said it all. And, you know, for some of our Black churches, that are in our Black communities, I want to urge a lot of your pastors and your members, you know, to make it a point to bring this to the forefront, and let's not sweep everything underneath the rug. You know, church should be more than selling chicken dinners and barbecues. Sometimes we need to put things on the table, some life and death situations. So Cherise, I can't thank you enough. Like I said, I could talk about this for so much longer, but I am so very thankful that God has brought you through this ordeal. Thank you for sharing your story. And I'm gonna have to bring you on again. We're gonna have to talk about some other topics because you definitely bring a whole lot to the table. I love when I can talk to my guests and they can talk about the goodness of the Lord and what God has done for them. So thank you so very much for being a part of this week. I wish you well, and whatever you need from me, just let me know.
Thank you. Again, I appreciate it. I'm honored that you asked me to be on the show, and that what the work that you're doing, you know, bringing awareness. And I just want to shout out, not just women, but men. Check yourselves too, because men can get breast cancer as well.
And I'm so glad you said this. People don't understand, but this is also, in addition to breast cancer, this is also prostate month as well for men. So you all represent the pink. We represent the light blue. So I just want to let the brothers know, hey, that's something that we need to get. We're going to have to look into, and I'm going to have a show about that going down the road. Well, listen, have yourself a fabulous, fabulous rest of the week coming up. And like I always say on my podcast, keep God first place in your life. He will take you places that you never dreamed of. Thank you so much for coming into the lab, and we'll definitely catch you on the other side.
Thank you so much. Have a good night.
Pick a Side Nation, thank you so very much for tuning in and listening to Cherise Champion Williams tell her story and her journey through breast cancer. I thank you so very much for tuning in, and I just thought it would be appropriate to have Yolanda Adams' song on here, "The Battle Is Not Yours But It's the Lord's," because surely that is what Cherise puts in her life, is nothing but the Lord first. And I certainly thank her once again. Thank you so much for tuning in. Listen to these survivors. We started out with Stacy Lynn Foxworth, then we had Trafinia Perkins, and now we had Cherise Champion Williams. Tomorrow's episode will be with Stacy Lewis from the Young Survival Coalition, someone that has been beating the drum about advocacy, and we certainly are waiting to hear that podcast on tomorrow. So thank you so very much, and we'll look for you tomorrow. Tune it in to the show. Thank you. That he can not heal. For all things work according to the Master's holy will. No matter what you're going through. Remember
Champion.